Hello, this is Lazarus at Telecom Tech, where telecom and networking technologies are simply explained. Today, we'll be simply explaining how to configure a multicast underlay on a VXLAN topology using Cisco Nexus switches. If you like my content so far and you're interested in seeing more networking and telecom technologies simply explained, then please subscribe now to the channel. And when you subscribe, make sure to enable notifications like so that you'll be informed of new content. If you like this video, make sure to click that thumbs up button. In a previous video, we made a detailed step-by-step examination of the multicast flood and learn control plane operation of VXLAN. If you haven't already done so, before going on, I suggest you first take a look at that video. It'll be helpful in understanding what we're actually doing in this video. You can find a link to that video in the description below. So what are we going to do today? Well, we're going to create the following topology using Cisco Nexus switches. Until now, in most of my videos, I've depicted the underlay network and the spine devices within it with several routers. However, typically in a data center or in a cloud infrastructure, you will most often find switches in these locations due to the fact that you need a lot of ports, even on the spine or the backbone of the network. And in particular, you would use data center type switches such as the Cisco Nexus series. It really doesn't make a difference to our configuration, as these devices are still functioning at layer 3. But just to be more realistic to actual real-life scenarios, I've changed the icons here. Now we're going to configure the multicast underlay such that VTEP 1 will be able to find VTEP 2 when PC 1 attempts to send an ARP request searching for the MAC address of PC 2. Now we assume that the underlay network has been configured already to support multicast. So our configurations today will be limited to our VTEPs, or our leaf switches. We also assume that VTEP 1 and VTEP 2 can reach each other over that underlay network. Now to start off with, our configuration is very similar to the one we did when we configured static VTEP peers. We will first need to configure the VTEPs such that their interfaces connected to the underlay network are correctly set up. To do this, we will issue the following commands. Here we can see in VTEP 1 that we are configuring the Ethernet 01 interface. The no switch port command converts that port to a layer 3 port, just like we would have on a router. And once that is done, we can then assign it an IP address. Now VXLAN on these switches requires a loopback interface to be configured as well on each device to act as the location of termination of that VXLAN tunnel. So here we'll configure loopback 0 with an IP address of 1.1.1.1. Now we configure the same thing on the underlay port of VTEP 2, including that loopback 0 interface and address. In this case, the loopback address is 2.2.2.2. Now these two VTEPs on both their physical interfaces as well as their loopback interfaces should be reachable to each other at layer 3 over that underlay network. That means that the underlay network should have routing configured such that they should be able to ping each other on both interfaces. Next, we have to configure the overlay network on our VTEPs. First, we'll create the VXLAN network identifier, or VNI. This is much the same as what we did in our manually configured VXLAN VTEP peers in the previous video. Now, I won't explain in depth here what we did since we've already done this in the previous video. Suffice it to say, however, that we have created within each VTEP a VLAN 10, and we've associated that VLAN with VNI 6501. We've also assigned that VLAN 10 to the Ethernet 02 access ports on both VTEPs on which PC1 and PC2 are connected. Now, the network virtual interface, or the network edge interface, denoted as the NVE interface in the Nexus config, is configured next. This again is very similar to what we did in our statically configured VTEP peerings. The only difference here is this command. And that's where all the magic happens with multicast. This command is used to correspond the 6501 VNI with the multicast group address of 239.1.1.1. Now, in our case, we only have one VNI, which corresponds to one multicast address. But if we have multiple VNIs configured within a VTEP, you can assign a different multicast group address to each one, thus having a one-to-one correspondence between the VNIs and the multicast group addresses. Now, the same thing is configured on VTEP 2 and indeed on every VTEP in our network where VNI 6501 is configured. That's it. The configuration is essentially done. The multicast flood and learn XVLAN control plane is now complete. VXLAN tunneling will now take place between VTEPs that share the same VNI and the same multicast addresses. So when PC1 now sends the initial ARP request to PC2, the VTEPs do not yet know which devices correspond to these particular hosts. When that ARP request reaches VTEP 1, it will use the configuration we just created to place the appropriate VNI in the VXLAN header and to send the ARP request, which is inherently broadcast, to a destination IP address of 239.1.1.1, which is the multicast group address that we configured that corresponds to our VNI. So all VTEPs with that multicast address will receive the ARP request. Now note that the source address here is that of the loopback interface we created, which actually terminates our VXLAN tunnel. So the ARP request will be flooded to all VTEPs that correspond to VNI 6501, including VTEP 2, which will forward that ARP request to PC2. Now that ARP request will reach PC2, and PC2 will respond with an ARP reply. That reply will eventually reach PC1, and PC1 now has the MAC address that corresponds with the IP address of PC2, and it can populate its ARP table. But we also have two additional benefits from this whole process that enables VXLAN to operate. First, the two VTEPs now have become network virtual interface peers, or NVE peers. We can now see this by issuing the show NVE peer command on our VTEPs. You can see that from the point of view of VTEP 1, we see the loopback 0 interface of VTEP 2 as a peer, and the state is up. You can also see the uptime of this peering. Similarly, you can see that VTEP 2 also sees VTEP 1 as an NVE peer as well. Now, the other thing that has been established is that the MAC address tables of both VTEPs have been updated with the MAC addresses of both PC1 and PC2, as shown in the output of this command here. You can see that on VTEP 1, the port that corresponds to the MAC address of PC2 is the NVE1 interface that we already created. It also states the IP address of the VTEP peer, which is 2.2.2.2. So from now on, any frame with a MAC address of all Bs here will be forwarded out of NVE1 and will be sent to 2.2.2.2 using the VXLAN encapsulation. And you can see a similar result in the MAC address table of VTEP 2. Now, after all of this process is done, the result is that when PC1 sends a frame to PC2 on the data plane, it'll put in the correct VNI in the VXLAN header, and based on those NVE peerings and the MAC address table, it will correctly forward the frame in an encapsulated UDP header with the correct IP addresses in the source and destination fields of the underlay IP header, thus reaching VTEP 2 and being decapsulated to ultimately reach PC2. So that was the configuration of VXLAN with Nexus switches using a multicast flood and learn VXLAN control plane. I hope you found this video useful, and if you have, please click that thumbs up button. If you'd like me to address other related topics, feel free to let me know in the comments below. And please subscribe to get updates to newly published videos. I'm Lazarus at Telecom Tech. I hope this has been helpful for you, and I'd like to thank you for watching.